Hello and welcome to the presentation. Let's begin. This will be a series of two presentations, the first one covering phases of insulin secretion, and then part two will cover insulin resistance. Let's begin with part one, phases of insulin secretion. So before we begin, if you haven't checked out this presentation on insulin synthesis and secretion, please check it out. It covers insulin's production within the beta cell and also the mechanism of insulin release within the beta cell. If you haven't seen it, please take a look at it. It'll help in understanding this presentation. The link will be in the description below and also in this corner up here as well. So let's briefly talk about endogenous insulin secretion. So endogenous just refers to our own pancreas secreting insulin. The number 8 right here is just a reference. There is a list of references at the end of the presentation just for further reading. So the amount of insulin produced by a healthy individual or a healthy pancreas is 18 to 40 units per day. Or if we go by weight, 0.2 to 0.5 units per kg per day. Insulin is unique. It's just not randomly secreted. It's secreted in a manner that allows us to keep our blood glucose levels in check. So we have background or basal secretion, and we also have peaks. So let's talk about this a little bit more. Let's begin with basal or background insulin secretion. So this is basically the insulin that is secreted by the pancreas while we're sleeping or while we're fasting. So for example, while we're fasting, our body still requires a steady supply of glucose, especially the brain. And our liver's glycogen storage will help provide that. The muscle also has a glycogen storage, but that glycogen there is for use by the muscle itself. So while we have a steady supply of glucose, we will also have basal or background insulin secretion occurring, and that will help to maintain our blood glucose levels in check. The basal secretion is about 0.5 to 1 unit per hour. Now moving on to peaks, remember glucose has a major impact on insulin secretion. It's a potent stimulator of insulin release. So when we eat food, our blood glucose levels increase, and in turn we also get insulin secretion as well. Insulin release can be up to 6 times from baseline and can peak within 60 minutes. So this initial short burst of insulin is termed the first phase insulin response. Now, as the glucose levels decline, the insulin will also gradually fall off. Again, as the glucose levels rise again to a steady level, there will be a second phase insulin response. We will cover the first phase and second phase in more detail in the coming slides. Now, to just one more point was approximately 50% of the total insulin secreted by a pancreas is under basal conditions, and the remaining will be in response to food. Another thing I want to point out about glycogen storage was that about 80% of the glycogen stored in our body is within skeletal muscles, and that's about 500 grams. The liver also has a high capacity to store glycogen, which is about 100 grams, but the liver is much smaller compared to skeletal muscle. Skeletal muscle is about 40 to 50% of our body weight, so the glycogen storage there has a much larger capacity compared to the liver. Only the liver contributes to the glucose release into the blood. Remember, when our body needs the glucose, the glycogen storage is mobilized to glucose and released into the blood so our body can utilize it. And this is especially important during periods of fasting. This, on the other hand, does not occur in skeletal muscle. Muscle glycogen is mainly for local use of the muscle, especially during periods of exercise. And the reason for this is that our muscles do not have glucose 6-phosphatase. Remember, this is an enzyme that converts glucose 6-phosphate into glucose. So here on the side we have glycogen, and we have the skeletal muscle and the liver right here. So when glycogen is converted to glucose 6-phosphate in the liver here, we have the glucose 6-phosphatase converts it to glucose. This can now enter the blood. Now, on the other hand, we have this same story in the muscle, but we have glycolysis that's going to occur. We don't have glucose 6-phosphatase within our muscle, so we cannot get glucose production. So instead, we go through glycolysis and we get pyruvate. Pyruvate has a lot of energy that can be extracted, so that will continue through the process of glycolysis. The end product we get is lactate, and that will just be released into the blood. So this is a hypothetical example of baseline meal time endogenous insulin secretion. So at the bottom we have time, and on the side we have glucose insulin levels. So the first line here is green. This is for glucose. So we have breakfast, lunch, and dinner, and we can see the spikes of glucose. And when that happens, we also have insulin. So the blue lines here are insulin. So as we mentioned earlier, between meals, fasting, overnight, there's a steady supply of insulin to help keep the blood glucose levels in check. So right here, the green line here is steady. Steady supply of glucose. We also have a steady supply of insulin. But when we eat, obviously, our blood glucose levels will increase. And as the blood glucose levels increase, we will have insulin to help compensate for the increase in blood glucose levels. As the glucose declines, so does the insulin. And the insulin will level off to the basal or background levels. Another point here just to mention is that insulin, remember, it's a protein. It's rapidly degraded. Its half-life is approximately 4 to 6 minutes. What is shown here is just the spikes in glucose, spikes in insulin. It's not showing phase two, for example. We will cover that in the next slide. Let's look at the phases of insulin secretion. So here we have time, and on the side here we have insulin level. So this is a insulin secretion curve for a non-diabetic, for a type 2 diabetic right here in blue, and for type 1, a person with type 1 diabetes, the line here in red. So here we have, this is phase 1, as we see here, the first spike in insulin release. And this area here is phase 2. Remember, in type 1, there is no insulin, it's absent, so that's why the line is flat. In type 2, we will come back to this area here of why there's no peak. So when is insulin released? We know that it's released when our blood glucose levels are high. In response to glucose, insulin will be released. Insulin, as we see here already, and we highlighted earlier, it's released in a biphasic pattern. So phase 1 and phase 2. In the first phase, it's a rapid burst of insulin, and that occurs within 30 minutes after a meal. The first phase here is mainly to help bring down the postprandial glucose levels. And I just mentioned a little while ago is that we can see here is that with type 2 diabetes, where is the spike? What happened here? Why is it absent? And we will come back to this in the next coming slides. Let's move forward. So the second phase here, as we see, is more gradual. It occurs over 1 to 2 hours. Until the blood glucose return to normal. When blood glucose is in the range of 4.4 to 4.7, the insulin levels will start to decline. Again, we don't want to go too low because then it'll push us into hypoglycemia. So the body is unique that it knows when to decrease the amount of insulin being released. Just another bit of information here. In phase one, when the insulin that's released from the beta cell, this insulin has already been synthesized and also is stored in vesicles. So it's ready to be released in response to a meal. Whereas in phase two, the insulin is also stored in vesicles, but also it includes newly synthesized insulin as well. So why do we have two phases of insulin secretion? So let's go through this. Glucose levels are maintained in a narrow range between 4 to 8 millimoles per liter. There's a fine balance between glucose release, utilization, and also insulin release. And this balance helps to maintain our blood glucose levels. Let's take a look at the graph below. Again, we saw this earlier. So we have time on the bottom and insulin level on the side. Again, it's a non-diabetic patient. So we highlighted earlier that glucose is the main stimulus, a potent stimulus for insulin secretion. So when we eat food, carbohydrates especially, this will cause our blood glucose levels to spike. So glucose is actually a major contributor to the first phase in insulin release. Now, there's also other nutrients we take in. So other macronutrients, hormones, neural input, some amino acids, fatty acids, acetylcholine, incretins. So incretins such as GIP, GLP-1, these actually are released from the gut. These factors also play a significant role in phase 2 insulin secretion. So we can look at it as though glucose has a more immediate effect compared to these other macronutrients, where these other macronutrients, hormones, these have, we can say, a more delayed effect, and that's why we get the phase two. So far, we know what triggers insulin and also the phases of insulin release, phase one and phase two. So here again, we have the same graph here. As glucose spikes, insulin will also spike. As the blood glucose levels decline, insulin will also decline, going back to basal background levels. So once blood glucose levels fall within range 4.4 to 4.7, the insulin will also start to decline. If blood glucose levels fall too low, 3.6 to 3.9, for example, if we're falling down here, for example, it's pushing us into the risk for hypoglycemia. And our body's response is to release counter-regulatory hormones. So these hormones counteract insulin's effect. So insulin helps to bring down glucose levels, whereas the counter-regulatory hormones help to bring it back up. So we have growth hormone, cortisol, epinephrine, or adrenaline, and glucagon, especially glucagon. There is a balance between the insulin and these hormones that help to regulate our blood glucose levels and also help to keep them in check. So how does insulin levels decline? What is the actual mechanism within the beta cell for this whole mechanism to occur? So here we have a pancreatic beta cell, and here we have a GLUT2 transporter. This transporter here is key in this whole process. The GLUT2 transporter specifically transports glucose, and it's insulin independent. It does not rely on insulin for its mode of action. It has a low affinity for glucose. It's more active when our blood glucose levels are high. So it has a high KM value of 15 to 20 millimoles per liter. We'll come back to this. So after we eat food, our blood glucose levels are higher. That's when this GLUT2 transporter will be more active. So KM value is just indicating the affinity of a transporter, for example, the GLUT2 transporter, for its substrate. And in this case, it's glucose. So if a KM value is low, it indicates a high affinity for its substrate. If it has a high KM value, it has a low affinity for its substrate. So the GLUT2 transporter has a high KM value. So it's active when our blood glucose levels are high. So after we eat food, our blood glucose levels are high. So this will actually allow glucose to enter the cell. The GLUT2 transporter now is active, so glucose enters the cell. Glucose will go through various mechanisms as we see here, with the end result of insulin being released. So you can see how important the GLUT2 transporter is. Now, when our blood glucose levels start to decline, about 4.4 to 4.7, the GLUT2 transporter will become less active. When it's less active, less glucose will be entering the cell, less of this mechanism will be occurring, and less insulin will be released into the blood. There's more information on the mechanism of this here. You can check it out in part one, insulin synthesis and secretion, and insulin effect on various muscle, adipocyte, and liver. These are two lectures that have been talked about previously. The link will be in the description below and also in the upper corner up here. Please check it out. This here is just a summary of insulin secretion pathways. As we already covered glucose and the GLUT2 transporter on the pancreatic beta cell, acetylcholine, GLP-1, and GIP, these both are released from the gut when we eat food, and they play a major role in the phase 2 insulin secretion. Also the amino acid arginine. So overall, these are just the various mediators and pathways for insulin release. That concludes part 1, phases of insulin secretion. Please check out the next video, part 2, on insulin resistance. The link will be in the description below and also at the end of the video. Just before we end, don't forget to subscribe for more videos. If there's a topic you would like us to cover, please leave a comment below. I hope you found this video helpful, and again, thanks for watching.